I'm going to start with not an Italian piece, and then I'm going to go to the Italian piece. This one has some Italian connection. This is the second movement from Felix Mendelssohn's Italian Symphony. This is a symphony that he wrote while he was traveling to the UK, but he reflected on his Italian traveling experience. He loved Italy, and he visited the country many, many times, from very north all the way to Sicily, so he really visited the whole country. And this particular movement is a reflection of church service in Italy. So you can imagine there's some singing going on, and then he uses cello and bass and the lower string instruments to simulate this neo-Baroque feeling. So it's like Baroque music, romantic melody, and Mendelssohn right on top of each other. And I love this piece so much that during COVID I decided, yes, I'm going to make it solo transcription, because it's too hard to find a four-hand duet partner. You know, during COVID that was hard. So what was the alternative? I guess I would do all the notes and play all the notes.
This is your transcription?
This is my transcription. So I'm going to play the second movement of the Italian symphony, and then I will play the Italian piece from this morning. Thank you. play the real Italian composer piece. This is the impressionistic Debussy, you know, sunken cathedral, but shorter version of that piece. And Dan, one of the fun things about this piece is he actually do play the lowest note on the piano. Couple of notes I played, those are E and B, and this next piece starts with note E, so here's the connection. This one is the first movement from Franck, Cesar Franck's violin sonata, without a violin, because I'm playing a solo transcription of mine, of the piece. Well, this is one of those really good chamber pieces, because the piano part is so hard that no matter how loud the violin or the cello is, you still hear yourself in the piece. And Franck wrote this piece later in life. You know, he's really a late composer in many ways. That, you know, in his teens, when he was just a teenager, late teen, he wrote a lot of program-like chamber music. So he would read a novel and he's like, oh, I want to write a piano trio. To the point that Franck's list really liked that. And then Franck had a father who I guess was not really a good father back then, and he's still really not a good father even if we judge him now. He pretty much said to Franck, when Franck was really young, that in order for you to stay in music school, because you know he didn't want him to go into music, in order for you to stay in music school, you must win all the competitions. By that, he really meant win first prize of all the competitions. So when Franck was in his early 20s, he entered the counterpoint competition, and he won first prize. Next year, he entered the organ competition and he won second prize. And that's problematic because his father said, okay, no more school for you. And instead he started touring around, not because he wanted to, not because he was like Liszt who really enjoyed that. No, he was forced from his father to tour around. So by the mid 1840s, he was just just, you know, he had enough of that. So he said, I had enough and I'm going to do my own thing. So he taught organ for a long time privately, and he really didn't compose chamber music until the 1880s. Mm-hmm. So that's quite a long time. So I'm going to play for you. This is the first movement from the violin sonata he wrote in 1886. And before he passed away, he started working on the second violin sonata, but never finished, so we don't really know that piece. After all, this particular violin sonata starts with very gentle accompaniments and very lyrical violin line, which is different than the typical German, you know, first movement from a sonata or from a symphony or chamber music. And he has climaxing the first movement, but really what makes the piece interesting is the three movements followed by that, which I'm not going to play because we don't have time. Those three movements all use the similar themes, fragments from the first movement. So the whole piece is really a cycle. Thus, the name for that is cyclic form. So here's the first movement from César Franck's violin sonata transcribed for piano solo. Thank you. follow some French music, but this time not really French music. Let me play for you the 7th prelude out of 24 by the Azerbaijan composer. And remember, this one has four lines at the beginning, right? And we talked about how to read that kind of thing. Now, the middle section is almost like Sergei Rachmaninoff, but went a little wild. So if you feel like it's a little wild, well, it's only 30 seconds long, this middle section. And it really has a mixture of Azerbaijan melody or motif with Debussy-like outer sections, and in the middle is sort of Rachmaninoff goes wild. So interesting. And I'm planning to learn the whole sonata that I showed you at some point, and maybe next time I'll play that for you. Chords in the middle, and marked with quadruple forte, whatever that means. Okay, now I'm going to play for you a longer piece by Franck. This is about 12 minutes. This one is called Chorale, which has something to do with chorale that all of you even sing in church, where you have, you know, writing some chorale as exercise for music, where you have played some chorale in churches. Now, Franck's idea of chorale is, how do I decorate something to the point that I can put a virtuosic piece out? And keep in mind, this is for organ, so of course organ can't play as many notes as piano, and virtuosity for organ might be you're having, you know, four different lines going on at the same time, and you have to handle all of them, right? So Franck took a French chorale melody from the Baroque era, and he actually took different chorale melodies, and he wrote three chorale for organ. This one is the final chorale out of three chorale, and it's actually the last work he wrote before he passed away. And he said, just like what Bach and Brahms said, before I pass, I must write something for the organ, and then they all die after. Brahms' last work is for organ, Bach's last work was for organ, and it's the same for Franck. So Franck wrote this in 1889, and this piece starts with a virtuosic introduction, kind of like a prelude, but unlike the prelude we were talking about 2 days ago, this one has nothing to do with the chorale tune. This one's just sort of like a free-formed prelude based on some chords and some loud organ pedal tones. And then you hear the real chorale, and then the prelude idea comes back, almost try to interject, and then he just decided, well, I'm going to write something else. So he wrote a little, almost like a song for organ. So the Romantic era organ playing, you can preset certain keyboards on the organ to, you know, some kind of nice flute-like sound, and some more like the clarinet, and there might be an oboe sound you can preset to, depending on how many stops you have on the organ and how many you can pull out. So then halfway through the piece, as if he said, okay, you probably got enough of the romantic song, then he started bringing back all the ideas from previous sections, including the prelude. So think about this, like you're improvising some preludes like 2 days ago, and how would you put that into a real piece and put that as part of the motif? And Frank has this magic, he put everything together towards the end of the piece. You hear all the chorale tunes, you hear the prelude, you hear the middle section like a song, and he gives you this terrific ending. And those kind of pieces were meant to play at a big Paris cathedral. So this is not a cathedral, but just imagine you're there and you hear this big organist play. Now, this work is much more famous in the organ community, and I like this work so much that I decided, well, I need to transcribe something for the piano. So I did that too. This year is the Franck year, as some of you know. He was born in 1822. So 200 years later, we're still celebrating Franck here. So this is Chorale in A minor, the final chorale, written in 1889, right before he passed. And I hope you're going to keep some of the melodies in mind in the first 6 minutes, and then they're all going to come back.
Thank you.
Was a big fan of Beethoven. You know, he during his time, a lot of French composers were trying to find their own identity, so they stayed away from Beethoven. You know, he thought, okay, Beethoven, that's German. But Franck really liked Beethoven. So speaking of quietness, well, I think one of the quieter Beethoven sonatas is the Pastoral Sonata. And now I'm going to play for you a piece called Beethoven's Minimalism by Krops, K-R-O-P-P, a German contemporary composer. He wrote this piece in 2018, so that's pretty recent, and this is a piece written for a project called Beethoven 250. So, you know, 2018, nobody knew COVID, right? They thought 250 composers were going to write 250 pieces for Beethoven's birthday, and those pieces are going to be performed all around the world. Wow. Well, that turned it into a recording project because of COVID. But I think some of the pieces are interesting. This one, I was talking to Peter about this earlier, and he had a nickname, and I think this is cool. He said, this is Glassy Beethoven. Philip Glass and Beethoven. The beginning sounds like Philip Glass, or maybe it is Philip Glass. You know, he has some repeated figures in a lot of his music. And then it kind of goes into Beethoven, goes out of Beethoven to some more Philip Glass, goes back into Beethoven. So I think it's a nice break from Franck. But this one is the modern approach about minimalism and how Beethoven might fit into that.
Thank you.
speaking of Beethoven, now I'm gonna play plus improvising Beethoven for you. This is the first movement of Beethoven's fourth piano concerto in G, opus 58, and I'm gonna improvise the cadenza. The cadenza happens probably about 15 minutes into the piece, so just wait. And the signal is the orchestra. Well, you know, I'm playing everything here, right? Solo transcription means I'm playing the orchestra accompaniment plus the solo parts. The orchestra has this interlude and then holds a chord for quite a while, and then I'm gonna give you maybe 3 beats of rest, so you can hear. Okay, that's the improvisation coming up. Now, this piece was written in 1805, completed in 1806. And it was so popular that in the late 90s, and this is, you know, not too long ago, in the late 90s, people discovered that in 1807, there was a publication of this piece for not whole orchestra and piano, but for piano and string quartet. And the arranger was Beethoven. Beethoven arranged, this is the only concerto that Beethoven arranged for piano and the string quartet. And I guess it was popular that he decided, I'm going to change a few things that I wrote in the earlier version. So this is a year later, and Beethoven had more ideas about how to put trills and melodies together. So you actually almost hear some of his later styles, you know, hidden here. And Robert Levin and the group of string quartet people, they recorded this. So there's a recording of that. And what was interesting is in the orchestra part, the original orchestra version, the string sections were hard, but not really hard. And Beethoven decided, well, now we don't have the wind instruments, so strings are going to do a lot of work. Now it becomes really hard. So this is the G major piano concerto that has a 3-minute or so introduction. Piano comes in, piano actually starts the piece and then kind of fades out. Orchestra introduced the theme, piano comes back, develop the theme. Now this piece, Beethoven actually uses the whole keyboard range. It's a little higher than Wallstein and Appassionata Sonata. And in this piece, you're going to hear 3 different themes, and they all represent different emotional stage. One is dreamy, the other one is more angry, and then there's one more lyrical and lyrical one. Now, in the middle, it's interesting how he put all the themes together in the development section. And then at the beginning of the recapitulation, the beginning of recap, usually we just have the same theme, right? The theme starts in the piano part really quiet, and then as if he got, okay, that's enough. He gives you the fortissimo version of the theme in the recap, and then we have all the journey again, followed by the cadenza and the conclusion. So I hope you enjoy the solo transcription of this piece, and I think this is the best Beethoven concerto out of all 5 for piano. Thank you. something really fun here and really short. Let me play for you a Russian jazz prelude. Yes, by a Russian contemporary composer. Oh, well, he now lives in Uzbekistan, but he studied in Moscow for a long time and had his early career there. And this is by Saparov, S-A-P-A-R-O-V, and he wrote 24 preludes. Guess what? He wrote 24 preludes in all major and minor keys in the style of jazz, but all written out for you. So this is number 16 out of 24 preludes by Saparov.